Hello, my name is Wei Yang. Today, me and Chris will be presenting our work entitled Human Grasp Classification for Reactive Human-to-Robot Handover on behalf of our collaborators at NVIDIA and the University of Washington. Given and taking objects to and from humans are fundamental capabilities for collaborative robots, such as indoor service robot and cobots for manufacturing. For human-to-robot handover, most existing work focuses on detecting handover intent or inferring handover trajectories, and most of this work assumes the human can just place the object in the robot's gripper. This assumption is not always true in scenarios where the human needs to pay attention to their tasks, such as fixing a car or performing a surgery. In practice, the humans hand objects over in different ways. For example, we can present the object on top of our palm or grasp the object from different parts or in different orientations. The robot should be able to recognize different ways of human grasps and take the object safely without hitting or pinching the human hand. One way to let the robot recognize human grasps is to estimate the 6D object pose and the human hand pose. However, state-of-the-art methods for hand pose estimation and object pose estimation focus on the hand or the objects independently. In computer vision community, there are some recent studies on jointly estimate of hand and object pose while the hand is interacting with the object. Although this is a very promising direction, the current accuracy is quite limited due to the heavy mutual occlusion between hand and object. Therefore, it is not ready for this handover application. In this paper, instead of estimate of hand and object pose, we propose to formulate the human grasp recognition problem as a classification task. Specifically, we discretize the ways of holding a small object into 5 categories, which include put the object on the open palm, lifting the object, or using a precise grasp from different orientations. We further define 2 categories with empty hand, which include a waiting hand pose and an empty hand with arbitrary pose. This would allow the extension to determine a giver's intent to hand over an object. To facilitate training, we collected a dataset which covers 8 subjects with various hand shape and poses by using an Azure Kinect RGBD camera. Specifically, an example image of a hand grasp is demonstrated to the subject. We recorded the subject performing similar poses for 20 to 60 seconds. The whole sequence of images are therefore labeled as the corresponding human grasp category. During the recording, the subject moved his or her body and hand to different positions to diversify the camera viewpoints. We recorded both left and right hands for each subject. In total, our dataset includes around 150,000 images. Here is an overview of our human-to-robot handover framework. Given an RGBD image, we first use Azure Kinect Body Tracking SDK to detect the hand. Then we crop the point cloud centered around the hand and feed the crop point cloud to a PointNet-based network to predict the grasp category of the given observation. The handover task is modeled as a robust, logical, dynamical system by following our previous work. It generates motion plans that avoid contact between the robot gripper and the giver's hand based on the human grasp classification. Here, we report the accuracy of our grasp classification model. The model is evaluated on a validation set collected with a subject who is unseen during the training. It shows that our model generalized well on unseen subjects. In addition, we conduct another experiment to evaluate the detection rate, which is defined by whether there is an object in the hand. This can give us an insight on how robust our handover system is against the hand and object occlusion. We compare the detection rate of our hand grasp classification model with PulseCNN, which is the state-of-the-art 6D pulse estimation method. From the results, we can see that our classification model achieves higher detection rate, especially when heavy occlusion occurs, such as when subjects grasp object in pinch side pose or in the lifting pose. Chris will further explain the details of our task planning algorithm.
Next, let me explain how we represent the robot task plan for human-to-robot handover. In particular, we need to be wary of two different types of disturbances that can occur during task execution. The first one is what we call task-level disturbances, where the prerequisites for a particular action are no longer viable, and therefore we have to go back and perform one or more actions to get into a good state to execute something like a grasp. This could be because the robot's hand configuration changed, or because the human's moved, the human has reoriented, or anything like this. It could also be due to perceptual error. Second, we have action-level disturbances. What action-level disturbances are is that they are scenarios where while the high-level action is fine, we still need to adjust the particular approach that we use to get there. For example, this would be replanning a motion in order to approach an object correctly because the human moved a few centimeters to the right or left. These issues can be caused by pose estimation, classification, or unpredictability on the part of the human. To solve these issues, we represent our task plan as a robust logical dynamical system. This is work that we presented previously at IROS 2019, and for more details, you can check out that paper. What follows is a quick review of RLDS. So, to execute a task plan with RLDS, we first need to represent high-level actions or operators by representing their logical conditions and effects in order to reach some particular logical goal state. The preconditions are the predicates, symbolic conditions that must be true before an action can be executed, run conditions are true while it's executing, and the effects are predicates that are true after executing that action. The policy itself is what we do to compute the action. So this can be a motion planner, a more reactive policy, a neural net. It can be anything that makes sense for the task. In our case, we provided a set of policies and their associated conditions for it. Let me give you an intuition for how this works. Each volume here represents the set of continuous world values that are associated with a particular set of logical conditions. So for example, if we want to grab this Domino's sugar box, we might start in the set of preconditions that say that we can begin to approach it. So long as the run conditions remain true, we continue to approach until finally we enter the higher priority state of actually grasping the object. Now we want to close the gripper, but if something went wrong, then we would find ourselves back in the larger set of preconditions associated with the successful approach to that object. And then we would be able to continue our execution once again. The execution algorithm itself that falls out of this is fairly simple. So given a chain of operators, we loop over all of them in reverse order, and as soon as we find one whose preconditions or run conditions as appropriate are met, we can execute it. In our case, there are four key operators that we care about in our task plan. We can wait for the human, we can find a plan and execute it, and then we can grasp an object and put it down. We performed two types of experiments in order to validate our combined approach, both our task plan and our classification system. First, we went through a systematic evaluation, and second, we did a user study. In our systematic evaluation, we compared three different versions of our system for human-to-robot handover. Each of these systems uses the same perception to track the human. It uses the Microsoft Azure camera mounted beside the robot's table. It also uses the same task model and planners, the same system as was described in the previous section. However, each one changes the way that we decide which graphs to take. In the simplest baseline, we take the object using a fixed grasp orientation. So we always grasp it from the top, regardless of how the human is holding it. In the hand pose estimation version of the system, we estimate the hand pose based on a PointNet++ based network. We adjust the gripper pose according to the hand pose that was selected. And finally, in our system, we adjust the gripper pose based solely on the hand grasp classification. We compared success rate and time to action completion. When looking at success rate, we explore separately success rate for planning, emotion, to go to the grasp position, and for actually taking the object from the human. Compared to the simple baseline, the hand pose estimation version was less often successful during planning, but more often successful whenever it actually found a motion plan. The reason is because the hand pose estimation was often inaccurate and often fluctuated, which resulted in a harder motion planning problem. But in the few cases where it was successful, it was easy for the human to hand off the object. By contrast, our version was more successful both in the planning phase and at achieving handovers. When it comes to planning time, compared to the baseline, we see that the hand pose estimation version generally took much longer. However, our version was on par to slightly shorter than the simple baseline because it adapted to how the human wanted to hand the object over.
We also conducted a user study to determine if our system is fluid for human and robot collaboration. We recruit 9 users. Their ages are between 20 to 36. 2 were female and 7 were male. The average age was 30. The study consisted of 3 rounds of experiments. For the first round, users were given 4 blocks and instructed to stand in front of the table and give the blocks to the robot one at a time. They were instructed that the robot would only take blocks if their hands are still, but they could hold the blocks any way they want. For the second round, we first demonstrated a set of 5 human grasps to the users. Then we told the users to hand over 4 blocks again. We encouraged them to try the predefined hand grasps, but they were able to use any other grasps they'd like to use. For the third round, we tested the user performance in the presence of a distraction. Specifically, the users were asked to watch a music video played on a laptop and counted the number of faces that appeared in the music video. At the same time, they have to hand over all the 4 blocks to the robot. In the end, we will ask the users how many faces appeared in the video. After all the 3 rounds of experiments, we asked the participants to fill a Likert scale questionnaire and explain their experience and thoughts. Overall, there was a range of responses, but users said that they work fluently with the robot and trusted it to do the right thing at the right time. They also believed that the robot was aware of their actions. We also manually counted the coverage of different ways of grasp during the user study. In general, our definition of human grasps covers 77% of the user grasp even before they know the ways of grasp defined in our system. This proves a good coverage of our human grasp design. Finally, we computed our quantitative metrics on the user study data. In general, we noticed that when users were distracted, the success rate of planning and grasp were lower, but the execution time is similar. For the face counting task, the average faces counted by the users is 12.9, with a standard deviation 3.48. This implies most users felt a certain level of confidence of the handover system and were paying a good amount of attention to the video. Interestingly, although the users were instructed that the robot would only take blocks if their hands is still, we still found some users might not be perfectly cooperative and tend to play with the robot. Thanks to the robust logical dynamical task planning, our handover system was robust to deal with this kind of interruptions. Still, there are some limitations of our handover system. The main limitation is that it applies only to a single set of grasp types. In the future, we'd like to handle a wider range of grasp and objects that users might want to use. Please visit the project website for more information. Thank you.